Hey, what's up with this weird website that seems to be pretending to be a destination for brickfilmers despite obviously being abandoned?
Forget everything you've seen. While it has only existed in a zombified state since 2008, brickfilms.com was once the main gathering place for brickfilming activity on the internet, with a long and storied history dating back to the year 2000. To briefly recap, by the mid to late 90s, people online would occasionally discuss brickfilming in Lego-centric news groups, and some brickfilms were made available to download from personal websites, though still very few and far between. This was slowly increasing in 1999, and would see a greater increase in 2000. At this time, the Lego fan discussion platform of choice was LugNet. On January 13, 2000, a post was made by Thomas Foote, sharing his newly created Lego webpages, including one he called Lego Home Movies. This page offered downloads of the first three brief brick films Foote had created, and also linked to another page with tips for anyone else who was interested in creating their own Lego animations. In April, another early brick filmer, Greg Perry, acquired Webspace and began sharing his brick films publicly, after having been discussing his Lego animation efforts online since 1999. Thomas Foote and Greg Perry were both interested in sharing their hobby and accumulated knowledge, with the hope of getting more people into LEGO animation.
Hello.
An opportunity would present itself to them in the summer of 2000, when the first adult LEGO fan convention was set to occur. BrickFest 2000 took place in Arlington, Virginia, from the 9th to the 11th of June. Greg Perry, a Virginia native, and Thomas Foote from neighboring Maryland both attended, and each gave a presentation on LEGO animation at the event. Thomas Foote hosted a hands-on demonstration with a computer and an animation setup, and also screened the start of his first major brick film project, Jake Technique, which featured impressive LEGO Technique figure animation.
Holy!
Ugh. Later that day, Greg Perry presented a screening of some of his own brick films on a television. The exposure to brick filming at BrickFest directly inspired some other attendees to try out LEGO animation for themselves.
The rebels need your help. Build us more ships.
LEGO and Star Wars join forces for the first time. So you can build up.
In 1999, the LEGO group had released the first LEGO Star Wars sets, which inadvertently played a major role in many adults rekindling an interest in LEGO. One such person was a man named Jason Rowalt, who soon realized the potential of using LEGO for storytelling. In 2000, Jason had a website devoted to the PC game series XCOM. He wanted his website to have a webcomic based on XCOM, but, lacking the requisite artistic prowess, decided on using photographs of LEGO to illustrate the story. Later that year, Jason attended BrickFest, where he witnessed Thomas Foote's panel on LEGO animation.
It's been a long time, but I don't remember exactly what he said, but I remember it lit a fire in me, right? I was like, you know, you don't have to just kind of put the sets together, and I don't know. You know, when you're an adult and you're doing stuff, you're not really playing with them anymore, right? You're kind of just like, what clever thing can I make, right? And maybe you make a diorama and you leave it up for a year or something, right? But you know, I had the thought, you can make a diorama and then you could move it around, right? That's pretty cool. And he and I talked after that, and he was kind of one of the first people that I kind of reached out to and said, you know, I think he was doing stuff with Technic guys, right? Which is a little bit bigger scale. So, you know, the animation was a little more interesting or a little more emotive. And I think he made one called Jake Technic or something like that, if I remember. But yeah, I was mimicking his stuff, right, for a while. Until, you know, you get your own style, right?
Jason began to consider creating his own LEGO storytelling in video form, but was unsure of what software would suit him at a time when there weren't a lot of easy answers.
It's the world premiere of LEGO Studios. Hook up the digital video camera to your PC and you're ready to roll.
As we covered previously, in late 2000, the LEGO group were introducing the LEGO Studios Steven Spielberg Movie Maker set, which would bring the idea of creating LEGO animation to a much wider audience. For Jason, this seemed like a suitable solution to his obstacle, and he purchased the Movie Maker set as soon as it was released in the United States. He posted a review of the set on LugNet, and unsurprisingly, he was disappointed with the quality of the picture it produced, but was happy with the ease of using it to create stop-motion animation and edit films, ending up with a positive impression overall. Jason began to occasionally discuss the use of LEGO Studios with other LugNet users, but the topic didn't come up particularly often, as Studios was still brand new, and LugNet lacked a clear section for discussion of it to take place in. Jason had seen a handful of LEGO animations scattered across the internet, and decided that he should create a website which would gather links to all of them into one place, in what he hoped would become the definitive directory for LEGO movies online. In December, Jason posted a request for people to send him links to any LEGO films they had online to be listed on his upcoming website, and he also planned to continue searching the net for all that he could find.
How are you, sir? Fine to see you today.
Jason was aware that he could run into legal trouble if he included the word LEGO in his website name.
I was trying to avoid legal entanglement with LEGO, basically, right? I didn't want to call it LEGO films, so I called it Brick Films. Well, everything was brick, you know, like Brickfest, Brick Golf, Brick Films, Brick whatever, right? Brick Wars was like a game system that I played that was fun. So everybody just called it Brick, basically, just to avoid we're calling it LEGO.
This is the earliest documented use of the term brick film being used to describe LEGO movies. And as the site grew in popularity, so too would the use of this term as the prevailing way to refer to them.
I'm watching a Spider-Man brick film. A brick film? What kind of lifeless idiot would watch that, eh?
Prior to this, there was no standard way to refer to the medium, and different people would call it by different names. With brick film becoming and remaining as a widely accepted standard, anyone who refers to their LEGO animations as brick films has a tie to this foundational era of the community, even if they aren't consciously aware of it. Though initially coining the term as the name of his website, Jason did encourage the use of brick film as the generic term to be freely used to refer to all films created with construction toys. Brickfilms.com was officially launched on December 16, 2000. The main attraction, the Brick Films Movie Directory, was split into four categories, grouping films of similar lengths. Each individual film listing linked to where the video file could be downloaded, and provided basic information as well as a description or review written by Jason. The information included the file size, which was particularly relevant at the time given the prevalence of slow internet and limited hard drive space, and also the file type, as different video codecs were required to be able to play back different file types. If you didn't know what you were doing, you might spend a long time downloading a film file, only to find that you couldn't get it to play on your computer. Initially, the films were listed in the order they were added, so for a while, the first brick film many people would have encountered on the site was the first film listed in the shortest length category. This short, Jar Jar Binks and the French Revolution by Mark Atkin, is one of the earliest examples of what became a minor trend in brick filming, which saw multiple films depict the death of Jar Jar Binks. Other areas of brickfilms.com included the resources page with links to other useful websites, and later the addition of interviews with creators of standout brick films, as well as tutorials and other articles written for the site. The contact page allowed you to submit your own films to the directory, and Jason's intention was to list every brick film that was submitted with a working link.
Today we're going to use it to destroy the source of our trouble, the sun.
The homepage of the site featured a news feed, which regularly drew attention to new additions to the directory, and other interesting things relevant to brick filming elsewhere on the internet. Before long, the site saw the addition of a forum where people could discuss brick filming with each other, which was at least partially inspired by LugNet lacking a designated section for the topic. As 2001 began, the directory listed 16 brick films. This, of course, was not the full extent of brick films available somewhere online up to this point, and some of the others were added throughout 2001, including some classics we have discussed previously, such as The Funhouse and 12 Bucks. Some films were never found or submitted, as they were created by people whose primary interests lay elsewhere, and so did not share them on LEGO message boards where they would have been more likely to be noticed by Jason, and others may have not been publicized outside of the personal websites they were hosted on, making them easily missed. There was even a short-lived LEGO animation fad secluded on Newgrounds, starting not long before the creation of brickfilms.com.
DJ Mellow Man.
Eventually, in 2004, Newgrounds would receive a demand from the LEGO group to remove videos featuring LEGO, which shouldn't come as a great surprise to anyone who remembers the reputation of the site in that time period. Brickfilms.com received an early boost in visibility from an article in the business section of the New York Times, published on January 15, 2001. This article reported on the release of the LEGO Studios Movie Maker set in the emerging medium of LEGO animation, with a focus on the brick filming activity visible online. The article featured interview quotes from Jason and mentioned how brick films online were primarily being made by adults with an audience of other adults in mind, which accurately reflects the demographics of the people who were most engaged with the internet up to this point. This does not mean to suggest that brick films online at the time were often obscene, but you could tell by the overall vibe, as well as the subject matter they often included or parodied, where the primary focus of the creators lay.
What happened was I made the site, I linked some videos like Spite Your Face. This was before they did anything for LEGO. They made like a horror one that was really cool, like a black and white one. And I linked that and like Thomas's stuff and a bunch of like early stuff, right? And like maybe one of mine. And then I don't remember how this happened, but the New York Times called me and they said, hey, you know, what this brick film thing, right? And I did an interview with them right before I went to Mount Everest. And I was gone like a month, right? When I got back, my roommate was like, all these people have been calling about brick films, right? I'm like, oh, that's weird. So, you know, I did like a whole, like a huge amount of interviews. And then it just, you know, I think people just read about it in, I don't know, Der Spiegel and the London Times and an LA Times. It was fascinating, all these, you know, and it got to the point where people would send me articles like, oh, Brick Films was in the news. And, you know, I didn't get an interview or anything. They just were writing articles, right? I'm like, oh, that's awesome. So, you know, we had a big influx, it blew up, etc., right?
By late January, the directory listed 26 films, which caused Jason to remark, who knew there were so many LEGO movies? The number would grow to 40 by March and 60 by the end of April. The shortest length category for animations under a minute mostly included people's early tests and short sketches.
I just can't take the pain anymore. What the? Goodbye, cool world. Oh my God!
For many viewers at the time, even being able to download and watch animations such as these would have been a great novelty, and they were particularly approachable due to their small file sizes. The most populous category was for films between 1 and 5 minutes long, and even from the beginning, the films contained here were generally more accomplished overall. The next category was for films between 5 and 25 minutes long, and for a while only contained some of the bigger projects from the 90s and 2000. It began to see more regular new additions as community members sticking with the hobby began to get more ambitious. The final category was for films over 25 minutes long, and initially, Jason questioned whether or not brick films of this length even existed. The category remained empty for a while, until the old Biff and Mario films were posted online and found their way to the website, which, needless to say, started things off strong. The only later films that would enter this category were the CG brick film Rocketmen vs. Robots, which looks primitive now but was considered impressive at the time, and Grand Theft Auto, which was the first truly feature-length brick film available on the internet, but was considered disappointing by members of the community due to being hard to follow and not including much stop-motion animation at all. Jason himself did attempt to create a brick film over an hour long, and he would release the first 13 minutes in mid-2001 under the title Vecna's Lens Part 1, but the full film was never completed. While many of the early BrickFilms.com community members were creating their films with the LEGO Studios camera and software, the majority of films available on the site actually weren't created with LEGO Studios. In 2000, webcams had become more widespread and affordable, and quickly took over from VHS cameras as the standard for brick filming. Before enough time would pass for other standards to develop, the early animations on brick films could differ greatly from each other in the frame rates they used and the ways in which the characters moved. A distinctive characteristic of this era is that it wasn't entirely uncommon to see animations featuring the larger and more articulated figures that LEGO released in certain technique sets from 86 to 2001. Technique figures are actually less suited to animation than they may appear, but some brick filmers, such as Thomas Foote and Russ Jensen, did manage to get good results with them. Technique animations were most often on the shorter side and rarely had much of a set to speak of, as a result of the additional difficulty inherent in filming with them. Even by 2003, it had become very uncommon to see Technique brick films, as the figures weren't all that widespread to begin with, and had since gone out of production. Although they can be tricky to work with, there is still plenty of untapped potential in these figures, if current active brick filmers wanted to track some down and see what they could do with them.
Man, that was a close one.
Right from the beginnings of the directory and the community, the influence of Star Wars could be felt in a big way. Given the popularity of Star Wars to early online video in general, and also that the first release of official Star Wars LEGO had gotten many older people back into LEGO in this time period, many brick filmers' early works were lightsaber battles or other Star Wars shorts. As projects became more ambitious, Star Wars brick films had an increased tendency to experiment with early uses of digital effects, even beyond the already commonly seen digital lightsabers.
R2, start audio recorder.
A well-known early project emerged after a French video game programmer known online as Banban saw Star Lego, a recreation of the opening scene of A New Hope, which was shared online in 1999. Banban was impressed by the brick film, but was disappointed that the shots of the ships in space just used footage taken directly from the original film. He took it upon himself to design a large Star Destroyer model and recreate the first few shots of the film. He showed this much to a colleague, who joked that now all he had to do was finish the entire film. Banban decided to take on this challenge, and began work on what became known as the LEGO Star Wars project, with the aim of recreating the entire film with as much as possible in actual bricks. This was an enormous undertaking that involved designing many large sets and vehicles, many of which had not yet been made as official LEGO sets. Banban released chunks of the project over time from 2001 to 2008, and although he didn't manage to finish the entire film, he did end up recreating an extremely impressive 53 minutes. Another well-known brick film by Banban is Battle Droid Band from 2003. In April 2001, a poll was posted on brickfilms.com to ask viewers their favorite film in the directory so far. The winning film was The Thing by Andy Thornberry, based on the John Carpenter film. While it may have benefited from some recency bias, this was one of the most impressive brick films created with LEGO Studios, with standout camera work and lighting. Andy Thornberry had previously created the LEGO Chainsaw Massacre, which was another notable film of the time. The runner-up in the favorite film poll was Brain Damage by Robert Thomas, which combined two of the most popular cultural phenomenons of this era, action heavily inspired by The Matrix and a nu metal soundtrack. A pair of brick filmers who were quickly making a name for themselves at this time were two English animation students who released films together under the name Spite Your Face Productions. The first brick film the duo collaborated on was the unhinged zombie film All of the Dead, which was shot on Super 8 film and released online in August 2000. Later that year, a past lecturer of theirs informed them of an art collective accepting pitches for a project to screen 20 films, each of 1 minute in length, based on 2001 A Space Odyssey in January 2001. Spite Your Face submitted a pitch to humorously retell the film using LEGO stop motion, which was accepted, and so work began on the brick film 1, A Space Odyssey. Spite Your Face did not have all the LEGO pieces they would need to realize the project, and without much time or money to work with, they tried asking around for assistance. They began discussing with multiple branches of the LEGO group, who eventually agreed to help the non-profit art project and sent along a supply of various pieces. The film packs a lot into its brief runtime, featuring much more extensive Photoshop and After Effects work than other brick films of the time, and some well-designed builds, including the climactic hotel room set constructed on top of a lightbox. 1. A Space Odyssey was screened as part of the 2001 project in a cinema in Scotland on January 20th, 2001, attended by Spite Your Face. The duo subsequently shared the film online, and also decided to see if they could take it further by sending it to British TV channels in the hope that it might be aired. They received interest from the BBC, who requested that new permission be sought from the LEGO Group for this purpose. This time, Spite Your Face's request made its way to a higher-up department at LEGO, and before they knew it, they were on the receiving end of a strongly worded phone call demanding that they make no further attempts to promote the film whatsoever, or else face legal action from powerful lawyers. Spite Your Face posted about the situation on the brickfilms.com forum and mentioned that the person from LEGO who contacted them actually hadn't seen the film, but particularly objected to a description that mentioned a minifigure being altered. Initially, Spite Your Face's future in LEGO animation seemed bleak, but upon further correspondence, cooler heads prevailed, and permission was granted to show the brick film at upcoming film festivals. These screenings led to offers for animation work, and ultimately the LEGO Group themselves entered discussions with Spite Your Face to hire them to create official brick films, which would have been of particular interest to LEGO as they were planning to release further LEGO Studios sets. 1. A Space Odyssey was even eventually made available to watch on the LEGO Studios website.
Epic, historic, and utterly Python. Monty Python and the Holy Grail DVD.
In 2001, many films were being released on DVD for the first time, often along with newly created bonus features. While the DVD release of the film Monty Python and the Holy Grail was in development, co-director Terry Gilliam was shown a webpage featuring photographs of humorous LEGO versions of scenes from the film. Gilliam and Monty Python producer John Goldstone thought that a video recreation in a similar vein to these photos would make for an amusing DVD extra, and so the LEGO Group were approached to collaborate on this idea.
Camelot! Camelot! Camelot!
It's only a model.
As LEGO were already in negotiations with Spite Your Face Productions, this project was assigned to the pair. With many of the memorable scenes from the film either being heavily dialogue-based or else too violent for LEGO, the decision was made to recreate the Knights of the Round Table musical sequence, as it would lend itself to more dynamic animation and would work as a standalone piece, with obvious beginning and end points. By now, the Holy Grail DVD contents were due to be finalized in less than a month, which meant that Spite Your Face were required to create the brick film very quickly in order for it to be included. The duo acquired pieces they needed from the LEGO workshops in Billund, which explained how unreleased prototype pieces made their way into the video. Monty Python and the Holy Grail in LEGO would go on to become one of the most widely viewed brick films for the next few years, and would have introduced many people to brick filming. In addition to its inclusion on the Holy Grail DVD, it was also available to view on the websites of both LEGO and Monty Python, and received a considerable amount of media coverage. It was also popular on video streaming sites that predated YouTube, such as iFilm.
Wait, streaming sites? Before YouTube? I can still barely comprehend there even being internet before YouTube.
Huh, it's going to be a while before we're talking about YouTube. Early video streaming websites did not allow the public to upload freely, and were geared towards short, independent films and viral videos. These sites either curated submitted content or required you to pay to put up films, which meant they never contained many brick films. But in May 2001, iFilm began a partnership with brickfilms.com, which offered the opportunity for some of the higher profile brick films listed in the brickfilms.com directory to be hosted on iFilm, where they could gain a wider audience. Brick films on iFilm were prominently displayed and easily found, meaning many people visiting the site for any reason might stumble upon them. A new edition could get tens of thousands of views in a matter of weeks, and even hundreds of thousands after a couple of years. The brick films chosen to be made available on iFilm were often based on, or recreations of scenes from, major films, similar to what would later become most popular among general audiences on YouTube.
My father made him an offer he couldn't refuse.
The LEGO Films category on iFilm linked back to brickfilms.com, helping to drive traffic to the website and to further films. With a community growing on brickfilms.com, an idea emerged on the forum for multiple brickfilmers to collaborate together on a short film. The format that was taken was for one person to create the first minute of a film and send it to the next person, who would then decide what direction to take the story before creating the next minute, after which they would send it to the next person, and so on. This initiative became known as the Brick Films Directors Project, and led to the creation of two collaborative brick films, each by a different group of four brick filmers. The resulting films were loose and haphazard, but the experiment influenced the desire to create more cohesive community project brick films with greater planning and scripting, eventually resulting in the release of the large-scale collaborative film Cleaning Time. July 2001 saw the occurrence of the second annual BrickFest convention, with well over double the attendance of the first. Jason Roll presented a screening of an hour's worth of some of the best films on brickfilms.com, including his own new release, Vecna's Lens Part 1. Jason remarked that on a big screen at BrickFest, you could tell a huge difference between brick films made with LEGO Studios and those shot with a better camera. This may sound obvious to modern viewers who have only ever seen Studios brick films blown up to the size of a YouTube video, but at the time, people watching video files at home would have most often viewed them at a size closer to their native resolution, which made the low quality less apparent. At the convention, there were also brick films screened by Greg Perry and by Thomas Foote, who premiered two new films, the slapstick soccer brick film The Big Match, and the 2001-inspired also-thwacked Zarathustra. This pair of films are arguably some of the best work by one of the major pioneers of brick filming, appreciated for their amusing ideas and expressive cartoony animation. At BrickFest 2001, there was also a panel about creating brick films co-presented by Jason Rolt and Thomas Foote. Some members of the audience who would go on to see later notoriety included... actually, never mind.
Hello, lovely lady.
By this point, brickfilms.com was receiving enough film submissions that Jason decided to seek assistance in maintaining the website. The site did not yet have a built-in submission system connected to the directory, so submissions were done through email, and each one required Jason to add a new directory listing manually. The first additional staff member added to the site was Jared Gilbert, also known as Lego God, who is still active to this day as a community member and occasional brick filmer.
Yeah, I just remember spending almost half a day downloading some of these movies, you know, on an old modem, you know, those kind of modems, and just be like, can I turn the computer off? No, I'm downloading the Lego movie. And then you have to download that player, that codec, and there's another half day gone. I remember that was a very big problem. But because of my thing, because I ended up being film directory guy after a while, it was something I had to do. I had almost every codec imaginable on the computer, and it was just something you had to do to watch the movies. I mean, it was, sometimes you had to hunt for some of them or get an old one to watch a specific movie, but in the end it was worth it. But of course, everything, you know, could have been 5 seconds or, you know, up to 20 minutes, you know, some of the Boyer and Lenny ones.
Whoa, dude.
By this point, there was already a noted trend of brick filmers creating their early works about robberies and bank heists, which caused one site review to humorously question, "Are all LEGO enthusiasts thieves at heart?" At the end of July, the directory reached 100 films listed, and in celebration, Jason launched the first official contest held by brickfilms.com. The classical movie contest gave people 2 months to create a brick film between 2 and 5 minutes long, set to a piece of classical music, with little to no spoken dialogue. In addition to being the first brick film contest with no connection to the LEGO group, this marked the first instance of a long-standing tradition in the community to have a film contest that runs for a couple of months each summer.
We'd kind of drum up interest every once in a while, right, to get people's creative juices flowing, right? That was really what it was about. All those contests were just more about, like, pushing the envelope, right? So, you know, when you have a contest and you have recognition, you have prizes, you know, it elevates everyone.
I think it, at some point it was to push filmmakers away from what they usually make. But in that too, you're also trying to make more content to bring more people into the fold, into the community that was being built at the time. It wasn't even so much about the prizes, even though some of them were pretty sweet and cool. But I think that was the main goal of a contest. I still think it is today.
The Classical Movie Contest received 10 qualifying entries, which provide a decent cross-section of the rapidly evolving community and their films by the second half of 2001. The frame rates used could vary greatly from film to film, and there still wasn't much of a regular manner in which people made the minifigs move, which can particularly be seen in the various ways characters walk. Standards such as the recommended frame rates to use and the most popular walk cycle that many people still use to this day would really only gain prominence in the following year. Some of the entries contain animation that actually holds up pretty well today, while others, unsurprisingly, are animated in ways that now look outdated, even among films relatively well executed in other aspects. Only 3 of the entries were created using LEGO Studios, which demonstrates how, in general, more invested community members were already trending towards using better equipment. The Classical Movie Contest offered prizes for winners of 3 different categories. The category Best Animation was won by Military Tattoo at Brickingham Palace, an impressively filmed depiction of a military display. Best Cinematography was won by Russ Jensen's surreal technique figure brick film Haunting Gibberish. The winner of Best Film was The Barber of Seville by Stefan and Marcel van Zwam, which follows a day in the life of a barber and his amusing interactions with his customers. This was one of the earliest films by Stefan, who would remain as a prominent community member for the rest of the lifetime of brickfilms.com, with multiple future contest-winning films and helpful contributions to the site. There was one more film that was intended to be entered into the Classical Movie Contest, but required a bit more time to be polished to completion. The Gauntlet was the first brick film to be publicly released by Jay Silver, and would more or less immediately cement his reputation as one of the most talented and respected members of the community. Jay Silver had been dabbling with brick filming for a couple of years prior, and had been an occasional silent observer of brickfilms.com, so when he noticed the contest going on, he decided it was time to create his first more substantial work. Jay recalled having heard that the well-known Edvard Grieg composition, In the Hall of the Mountain King, had been written to accompany the story of an imprisoned peasant attempting to escape before being chased by giant guards, which gave him an instant story and perfect piece of music to accompany it.
It's the first one I released, and it's actually the first one that's got any semblance of a story that has a beginning and a middle and the end. The rest of them were all, yeah, there were animation tests and there were effects tests and they were, yeah, it was all the lead up. And in fact, I'm not even entirely sure when I did The Gauntlet that I was really super ready for it, because if you look at it, there's a lot of rough stuff in there and stuff I wouldn't do the same way again. But I had just recently found this online community, and there was, because before I had made a movie and then I was looking around and I would see little bits, if I searched, that you could find little bits, different movies. But this is the first time I really found this community, and so then they had a contest, and that was what I really needed, was a deadline and some sort of structure. So it was almost predetermined because of the music that I was going to use. Not only did I have a theme that I had to go by that gave me some structure, but I actually had structure based in the song itself, and it also gave me a finite length to work with, which is nice. So I patterned things out that there's sort of a slow build-up, and then there's a clear point when the whole thing, there's a tipping point in it, and that was my reveal of the big monster, so I didn't have it all the way through, and then after that it was just a straight-out chase scene.
At a time in which many brick filmers still found it novel to be able to create anything at all, and generally were producing charming yet scrappy work, The Gauntlet came as a revelation in how it approached the medium. With greater consideration given to cinematic techniques, it came across as a much more legitimate and engaging piece of work than other brick films of the time, while still maintaining enough levity to not seem like it was taking itself too seriously for a film made with Lego. It was simply on another level in terms of its overall direction, shot composition, lighting, production design, and manner in which its plot unfolds. It has often been praised for the execution of how the story builds along with the music, and the sequence in which the golem rounds the corner right as the music hits its peak is one of the most iconic in all of brickfilming.
The thing I really liked about that was almost everybody was making, like, just, you know, the dialogue or whatever or something with figures. No one was making the kind of macro animation, right? Like, he made a whole giant figure and animated it, right? That's much more difficult and, to me, more interesting than just having many figures.
So big characters like this guy, I haven't done a whole lot of that sort of thing. And in fact, I wish that I had when I got partway through this, because this guy, he was very difficult to use for me. I tried to model him for aesthetic reasons and just wrapping my head around it reasons. Basically, he had the same articulation as a minifigure, like his feet worked in the same sort of fashion. But it ended up that he was really hard to work with because his arm was being held on by just the tiniest little gear, so it would constantly slip out of where I had it, and his head was pretty loose. And the biggest problem by far with this guy was his feet and his weight, because when I would get his feet off center, like he's taking a step, he was extremely tippy, and so I had to come up with all sorts of, and I don't remember exactly what the method was now of jamming something under there that wouldn't be seen by the camera, but at the same time would hold him up, because if he went, and he did go a couple of times, it was game over, because my set was set up on top of my scanner at the time, because I just wasn't experienced enough to know that it should be a very solid thing that it should be on. So when he went down, the walls went up, and the little guy went flying.
The gauntlet paved the way for other brick filmers to give more consideration and aim higher with their own visual storytelling and other areas of filmmaking. For years to come, it would continue to open people's eyes to what could be achieved with the medium, and it remains a more carefully thought out, effective film than many brick films even today.
I just remember it being a moment where, I don't know, people decided that Lego movies were an art form or something to... It seemed to be one of the first movies where you wanted to strive to be as good as. And it was... Even to this day, just a month or two ago, I showed it to, you know, my son, you know, to show him these, and it still holds up. It's still as good as it was.
When I released the gauntlet, it was actually late for the contest. I have this thing that if something's not right, I'm not gonna put it out there, and so I released it a week later, and it was a really, really positive response, and a lot of people. They seemed really interested in some of the things. Compositing, for example, in brick films was kind of a new thing. It was, for the most part, it was whatever you've got in the scene, the actual bricks. But I'd put bits of fire in there, and I'd put a light beam coming in. People were interested on how I had done that. And so I was answering questions on that sort of thing. And they also, they were keen that it was widescreen, that I'd intentionally taken my 4:3 image and cropped it to make it a widescreen, a very movie-like image. And that I'd also taken the time to get the camera down on the character's eye level, so you felt that you were at the same height as this guy. It almost made him feel more real. And some of the camera angles that I had chosen were more like you'd find in a movie. And I think it was one of the earlier ones to have that sort of cinematic feel. And I think it helped push a lot of people into that. Yeah, they can be more movie-like. It's not just about filming a toy, it's about making a movie with these toys.
The Gauntlet went on to help Jay get a job in the animation industry, where he would work his way up to the role of animation director. He never forgot his roots in brick filming, and can still be heard lending his considerable voice acting talents to brick films from time to time.
What? Me merchandise!
By the second half of 2001, the brickfilms.com community was growing to the point that some site expansion was required. In August, the film directory was reworked so that instead of all films being listed on one webpage, the four length categories were each given their own page and listed individually. Some of the categories even grew to requiring multiple pages each, as more films arrived over time. Another change was the establishment of a new community discussion forum. The forum had initially been a pretty bare-bones message board hosted externally on a site called server.com, but in August 2001, a new brickfilms.com forum was established on easyboard.com, which was a popular provider of free message board hosting at the time. This superior forum hosting was more customizable and allowed for greater organization, with multiple categories to group threads by topic. It also allowed users to post from an actual account with an avatar, rather than just signing their name on each post. As a more familiar sense of community continued to develop, people would begin to sometimes contribute voices or other help to each other's films. Inevitably, there was also the occasional argument that could flare up on the forum, with one incident even leading to a brief, lighthearted fad that saw brickfilmers making animations in which they fight one another.
Why is everything always gonna be a fight with you, man?
Never mind. Let's get out of here.
One of the well-known brick films of 2001 is The Rescue by Jason Alleman and Dean Van Leeuwen. This pair had previously released a trio of Star Wars brick films in 2000, and The Rescue was their largest and ultimately final brick film project. The film is a well-realized recreation of the opening of Raiders of the Lost Ark, with a number of additional sight gags and crossovers with Star Wars. While it did receive thousands of downloads in its day, The Rescue would receive its most widespread popularity when somebody who had downloaded it put it on YouTube in 2006 under the bankable title Lego Indiana Jones, garnering millions of views in the process. Jason Alleman eventually started his own YouTube channel, where he became well known for videos of intricate Lego sculptures with moving parts, and a couple of his designs have even been released as official Lego sets through the Lego Ideas program.
Ideas submission?
Throughout 2001, brickfilms.com continued to receive attention from various major publications and websites. The media often seemed fascinated by the presence of LEGO films with more mature themes, and would more or less invariably mention the series Rick and Steve, the happiest gay couple in all the world. This series originated in 1999 when filmmaker Q. Allen Braca was studying at CalArts and was tasked with creating a short film about relationships. Braca was inspired by the observation that popular media was occasionally including single gay characters, but was basically never depicting queer families or loving relationships. A lack of resources largely informed the decision to create the film with Lego, which made for convenient characters and set-building material. The 8-minute film was presented as if the first episode of a sitcom following multiple gay couples, and featured considerably explicit humor and themes.
Hello!
God, did you have to say the actual word?
Braca submitted the film to the LA-based queer film festival Outfest, where it went on to win an audience award, and began to attract attention from worldwide film festival programmers. The film began racking up many further screenings and awards, with appearances at some high-profile festivals including the Sundance Film Festival and Spike and Mike's Festival of Animation.
I'm so excited!
Me too! I can't believe it!
The buzz generated by Rick and Steve Episode 1 led to an early internet video venture providing funding for 3 further episodes, which were added to festival appearances and began to debut online in late 2000.
Straight boys!
The Rick and Steve series continued to be a hit at festivals, and would eventually amass around 200 different appearances in total. With its rising profile occurring around the same time as the release of LEGO Studios and the growth of brick filming online, Rick and Steve was an obvious choice to receive specific attention in media reports on the emerging medium. Although the vast majority of films listed on brickfilms.com were appropriate for general audiences, the media liked to point out that people were also making LEGO films with serious subject matter or adult humor, and the explicit content of Rick and Steve was often detailed. Alongside Rick and Steve, another brick film that began to get mentioned following its October 2001 release was Girl, by a prominent community member known as Egoless. Egoless often created brick films with themes of spirituality or basis in different religions, and Girl was a music video set to an overtly Christian country song about a young girl who finds comfort from Jesus while under the roof of unfit parents. The video rather bluntly depicted everything told in the lyrics, resulting in some scenes that surprised people to see depicted with Lego.
Her daddy drank all day and mommy did drugs.
Legetøjsfirmaet Legos figurer er endt på rollelisten i flere amerikanske film. Lego-mænd og damer optræder i scener med sex og vold. Det vil virksomheden nu have stoppet.
Det handler om sex, vold og stoffer. Socialrealisme i højeste potens. Der er tale om de såkaldte brickfilms.
With some of the media attention focusing primarily on brick films such as these, the LEGO Group were asked for comment and stated that they were considering taking legal action against brick films which went against their values. Egoless anticipated receiving a cease and desist notice, but never heard from LEGO, who ultimately did not pursue any action against Girl. A different fate befell the higher profile Rick and Steve, as LEGO eventually demanded that the films and all images from them be removed from the internet. This understandably caused some concern among brick filmers, but luckily, LEGO taking action against brick films online did not become much of a reoccurring issue going forward. Rick and Steve would later be adapted into an animated TV series which ran for 2 seasons on an LGBT-focused sister channel of MTV, with original puppets reminiscent of toys. In December 2001, Jason Rold announced the second BrickFilms.com contest, the historical fiction contest, shortly before the 1 year anniversary of the website.
Wait, we've only covered 1 year?
Ha! That was just the beginning. There's so much that happened in 2002. But we have covered enough for one day.
I can't believe I once thought we'd already be talking about Mickey Doodles by now.